Hi, I'm Shashank Bhargava, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. In this episode, we talk about the Bengaluru rains and the reason why large parts of the city remain heavily flooded. We also talk about legislators of opposing parties coming together in UP to help their constituencies. But first, we talk about the United Kingdom. Back in July, Prime Minister Boris Johnson resigned from his position after being involved in a series of scandals and several ministers leaving his government. But now, after more than 2 months and a bitterly contested election, Liz Truss has taken Johnson's place to become UK's 56th Prime Minister. Truss had earlier served as the Foreign Secretary in Johnson's government and has held various cabinet positions in her more than 2-decade-long political career. Here's what she said in the beginning of her winning speech earlier this week.
It's an honour to be elected as leader of the Conservative and Unionist Party. I'd like to thank the 1922 Committee, the party chairman, and the Conservative Party for organising one of the longest job interviews in history. Thank you very much.
Now, Truss has become the Prime Minister at a time when UK is facing multiple crises, including that of inflation. In this segment, we speak to Professor Harsh Pant about these challenges, Truss's win, and whether her appointment will affect the relations between India and the UK. Pant is a professor of international relations at the King's College London and the vice president of studies in foreign policy at the Observer Research Foundation. Professor Pant, Liz Truss actually fought a very closely contested election against Rishi Sunak, who was the chancellor under Boris Johnson, and it had initially seemed that he was going to win. Could you tell us what turned things around in Truss's favour?
Well, you know, eventually, once Mr. Johnson decided to leave, there were a number of people who were part of the leadership fray. And in the end, of course, we had the two front runners, Liz Truss and Rishi Sunak, who were competing against each other. And when both of them had started off, Mr. Sunak had a lot of momentum behind him because he was the favourite of the parliamentary party of the Conservatives. So in some ways, he had the backing of the most number of MPs. He was seen as more suave, more articulate. He was seen as a candidate because of being the Chancellor of the Exchequer. He was seen as the right person at the time when the British economy was in trouble. So I think there were a lot of factors that were going for him. And of course, he came from a multicultural background in that sense, and he was seen as the exemplar of British multiculturalism. So I think there was a lot of interest in him. There was a lot of momentum behind him. But in some ways, all those things actually started working against him as the leadership contest moved forward, because he was actually seen as part of the problem, given that British economy is doing particularly badly and people have been hurting. Ordinary Britons are facing inflation, energy crisis. There is a lot of trouble on the union front. There is a widespread question mark over the winter setting in and how the heating and gas supplies would be restored at affordable prices. And he was the one who has been saying throughout his campaign that he would actually prefer not to cut taxes, but rather bring public finances under control.
Just borrowing more money and stacking up bills for future generations to pay is not just economically irresponsible, it is immoral. Whilst I know tax rises are unpopular, some will even say unconservative, I'll tell you what is unconservative. Unfunded pledges, reckless borrowing and soaring debt. So yes, I want tax cuts, but in order to do that, our public finances must be put back on a sustainable footing.
And on the other hand, you had Liz Truss, who was reaching out to the Conservative base by positioning herself as Thatcherite, as a self-styled heir to Thatcher, Margaret Thatcher, that small government, small state, low-tax Conservative. And she has been consistently arguing that we need to cut taxes in order to revive economic growth. And at this particular point in time when people have been hurting, her message was resonating with the base. So while Mr. Sunak was popular with the parliamentarians, what worked in Ms. Truss's favour was that she was able to appeal to a large number of Conservative base who wanted someone who can actually help the ordinary people at a time of great distress. And she seemed more attractive And then Sunak, who was giving bad news almost that this state support cannot be done in the absence of strong public finances.
I have a bold plan to grow the economy through tax cuts and reform. I will cut taxes to reward hard work and boost business-led growth and investment. I will drive reform in my mission to get the United Kingdom working, building and growing.
So I think that challenge, that primarily the economic situation turned against him. Sunak was seen as close to Johnson. He was seen as part of the problem. Of course, there were a number of other episodes that Sunak confronted, including his lineage, including how he had a green card, how his wife had money that was unaccounted for and she was not paying taxes in Britain. A number of those factors were important, but ultimately it turned around. The campaign became about who can attract the largest number of conservatives from the base. And Liz Truss was able to do that and Sunak wasn't. And that's it.
And you mentioned, of course, that the UK right now is facing a cost of living crisis. Inflation is running above 10%, energy prices are up, and winter is coming, which means people will be using more heating. So could you talk about the challenges that Truss will be facing going forward?
It's going to be primarily, you know, the economic challenge that Truss will have to address first, because this is a particularly difficult moment for Britain. In a sense, the divorce with the European Union is not fully settled. And the costs of the war with Russia, the Ukraine crisis, are beginning to be felt in the streets. And therefore, for many in Britain, this is a time when they are expecting the state to come in and help them. Now, of course, the first thing that she's likely to do is to do something about the energy prices. There is a talk of a cap on energy prices, and everyone is demanding it, and the energy firms are facing a lot of problems. The people are facing a lot of problems, are facing lots of problems. So energy crisis is going to be the most important immediate challenge, you know, within the wider ambit of the economic crisis that Britain is facing. Now, if you read the trend lines, the expectation is that the inflation is only going to get worse before it gets better. So I think there are some who are expecting it to reach as high as 23% by early 2023. So that's a remarkable number. And that's a very difficult economic crisis for anyone to manage. And what she has unfortunately promised is a tax cut. Now, which means that we'll have to deliver on one of the most important promises that she has made. But the public finance situation is very, very bad. If you don't have governmental resources, how is the British government going to help those who actually need it? And this was something that Mr. Sunak had been pointing out, that, look, we can't be responsible about our economic finances. So it's going to be an enormous for Ms. Truss to manage public finances at a time of dwindling resources, at a time of high energy prices, and at a time when a number of things are not going in Britain's favor.
Okay, and the other crisis that Truss is going to face is a political one, because her party seems very divided right now. And according to some polls, Boris Johnson, despite being involved in a number of scandals and resigning, continues to remain more popular than Truss, right?
Yes. I mean, it's like people are being asked to think of Ms. Truss's ability to govern. And there he's polling very poorly. And Boris Johnson, of course, is across, you know, the spectrum, polling relatively better. But Boris Johnson has always been a very recognizable name in British politics. It's natural that people, even from other political parties, would say that, look, we know this person, we know what he's capable of. But I think what Boris Johnson at the moment has done, which will cause trouble for any of the conservative leaders who follow him, is that he has made the Tory a brand of malgovernance. So the Conservatives were always trying to showcase themselves as the party that can actually govern, and that can actually make difficult decisions, that can provide effective governance. Because at times, the Labour Party in the past had been faction-ridden, you know, not centrist enough, devoid of any ideological coherence. Whereas the Tories were always seen as a party of governance. The last few months of Boris Johnson have been one where he has basically given this brand a very bad name. So I think in some ways, Liz Truss is under the burden that the legacy that Boris Johnson has left behind. And it's going to be very difficult for her to shackle herself from that legacy. And some would say that one of the reasons why Mr. Johnson would poll better than Liz Truss at this point is because very few people actually know what she stands for. And whereas Boris Johnson, that was never a problem. You know, you always knew what he wanted. He wanted Brexit, he got it. He wanted to be a prime minister, he became a prime minister by talking about certain kind of an economic nationalism. But with Liz Truss, she has had a very jaded background. She was a liberal Democrat. before she became a Tory, she was for UK remaining in the EU. And then she very seamlessly moved into a position where she was opposing, where she became a Brexiteer, supporter of UK exiting the Brexit. So I think people are just wondering at this stage what she stands for. People don't know enough about her as a foreign secretary, while a very important position. It's not a position where you are dealing day in and day out with ordinary Britons. And so at some point, she will have to get herself acquainted to British people. And therefore, they will make an assessment later on. So I think these polls are at this point relatively early assessments, which may not matter much in a matter of months when things settle down and people have a better understanding of what she wants to do and how she plans to govern.
And Professor Pant, do we know whether or to what extent Liz Truss becoming the new Prime Minister could affect UK's relationship with India?
Well, you know, in terms of India-UK ties, I think in the last few years, we have reached a point where personalities have become less relevant in shaping that trajectory. We have seen continued support for India in the UK despite changes in prime ministers. And they have, and prime ministers have changed very rapidly there in the last few years. David Cameron, Theresa May, and Boris Johnson, and then Liz Truss now. But despite that, what has been a sustained process is one where the engagement with India and the trouble spots on India-UK relationship have been largely marginalized. Now, there are obviously various reasons for it, and the most important reason being that there is a disenchantment now in the West with China, and there is a greater recognition of India as a critical anchor in the Indo-Pacific. And as the Western countries try to become more potent players in the Indo-Pacific, they are keen on engaging India, they are keen on working with India, recognizing India's importance in that geography. But also, I think the realization that a number of British efforts, whether it is economic revival post-Brexit, whether it is sustaining their service industry, whether it is the larger defense and security priorities, they cannot be met without a robust relationship with India. So therefore, you know, the UK-India agreements that were signed when Boris Johnson visited India earlier this year, those frameworks will continue to guide the relationship. And Liz Truss, during her time as foreign minister, was also very, very positive and optimistic about India-UK trajectory. So there is no reason to doubt her commitment to India-UK relations. The question is if she's sucked into the domestic political milieu much more strongly, given the challenges that Britain is facing, would she have the capital to invest on foreign policy and in particular in India-UK relationship? Because so much is happening in Europe at the moment. Domestically, the challenges as we have been discussing, strategically, the challenge that has arisen because of the Russia and Ukraine crisis. And given that, will she have enough bandwidth to devote to India-UK ties? That remains to be seen. But there is no reason a priori to doubt her intention to work on that, given her past experience and past engagement with the subject.
And next, we talk about Bengaluru. For the past few days, large parts of Bengaluru, India's IT capital, have been facing severe flooding. For many, daily lives have come to a standstill, and the government and civil society groups have been rescuing people using tractors and jeeps. In this segment, we speak to Indian Express's Aksheev Thakur about the current situation in the city. Aksheev, could you begin by talking about when did the city start getting flooded?
So the city initially got flooded on August 30th. That was for the first time when we had more than 100 mm of rainfall inundating the paths in near Marathalli, Varthur, especially in the Mahadevpura zone of the civic body BBMP. Now, the moment the civic body sprung into action, stating the chief minister visited these flooded areas and gave the directions initially that the encroachments have to be removed because it was found out by the revenue minister, by the BBMP and the other revenue department officials that the flooding has happened because of rampant encroachments along the stormwater drains, which has impeded the flow of the rainwater. So while the civic body was at it immediately on 5th of September, it again rained. And this time the rainfall was 131.3 mm of rainfall, just short of breaching the 8-year-old record, because in 2014 we had 132.6 mm of rainfall. So this was the scenario leading to a complete inundation of the outer ring road area, because this particular area, outer ring road, is now surrounded by the lakes. Now, these lakes, especially when we talk about the infamous Belandur Lake and Varthur Lakes, these lakes got breached completely and the water started flowing outside on the road. The reason was the upstream of these lakes are Kaikondrahalli Lake, Solkere Lakes. They started overflowing. Now, ideally, these lakes actually empty themselves, connect themselves to Belandur and Warthur. The reason that the interconnectivity between these lakes have lost due to the encroachments, and the reason was that the city got flooded, especially in those zones, particularly in that area. Now, when we talk about the flooding of the road, the scenario was not bad in the southern part of Bangalore, Bangalore South. So Bangalore South braved it. But the when we talk about the Mahadevpura zone, the Dasarhalli zone, the city got completely inundated there.
And could you also describe just how this flooding has affected people in the city and the kinds of visuals people have been witnessing?
So initially, when we talk about the IT companies, most of the IT companies, Manyata Tech Park, Bagbane Tech Park, are along these stretches where the flood fury had actually taken place. So the scenario was such, when we talk about the gated communities where most of the uber rich people of Bangalore and the CEOs of the companies, they stay. So these areas got completely inundated, and the scene was such that these villas where people are staying, especially when we talk about Rainbow Drive layout or apartments in Yembalur. So the tractors had to be deployed to evacuate the stranded people because they were completely immobile. And in some of these places, there was no electricity for 14 hours, 15 hours. And the BBMP had to pump out water. So initially it was so that the authorities had to wait for the water to recede because the situation was so bad that even tractors could not be plied in that particular stretch of the residential premises. One resident actually described, who stays in Sarjapur Rainbow Drive layout, he described that in the ground floor of the residential premises of Rainbow Drive layout, the situation was so bad that the refrigerators were floating inside. And the pet dogs were misplaced. They lost their belongings. When we talk about the slum areas near Belandur, the slum dwellers, over 1,500 houses completely got inundated, and snakes entered in the houses. They had to spend their night on the plains. Meanwhile, while the authorities were sprung into action, pressed into action near the residential gated communities, now these slum dwellers were completely left at their own thing, and activists and the volunteers had to go there to give them food and water. So the situation was that bad initially. And since the tractors could not be plied in the residential gated communities, the NDRF, and yesterday when the Madras sappers from the Indian Army had to be pressed into action to get the rafts and the motorboats inside so that the stranded people could be evacuated on the plains.
And could you also talk about how this has affected businesses and just the daily lives of people? And have schools and offices been shut in the areas where flooding has taken place?
So on August 30th, Shashank, when it rained heavily, the Outer Ring Road Companies Association, it's an association that represents the firms that there on the Outer Ring Road. So they had written it to the Chief Minister stating that they had incurred loss of ₹225 crores. And this was because of the inundation of the area. And second, the business communities had to give their work to the other people and their staff could not enter the premises. And this has actually led to a huge loss. And they had also stated the reasons that in the past one decade, they have been asking the government, requesting the government to enhance the infrastructure as far as this area is concerned, because since this is an IT hub, but no request has been heeded to. This was there, and initially on that particular day, there was no work from home that was given. But within a week, when 1.3 mm of rainfall again struck, the Outer Ring Road Companies Association had asked its members that they can actually work from home. And the schools had declared holidays for the next few days because the buses could not be plied in that area. So this was the scenario even yesterday when there was a very minimum rainfall of 40 mm. Still, the water took time to recede, and it's going to take, I guess, even today if it doesn't rain. So it's going to take time. So till 9th of September, most of the companies in that area will be working from home.
Okay, so you mentioned two reasons behind this flooding. One is, of course, the heavy rainfall. But the other is the encroachment that has taken place in areas where there are storm drains, which are ideally supposed to take care of the excess rainwater. And in this regard, there was a study that came out by the Indian Institute of Sciences some years ago. Could you tell us what that revealed?
Yes. So the Indian Institute of Science has come out with a study stating that since Bangalore comprises of ridges and valleys and the water flows through these valleys, the satellite images have been shown to the government and to the public that the constructions have taken place along these valleys, which impedes the flow of the water into the lakes. We have seen that the lakes like Belandur and Warthur, the wetlands which were interconnected to each other, have been thoroughly encroached over the years in the past one decade. and therefore there is no place for the water to escape. Second reason, when we come to the stormwater drains, the problem is that, again, over the years, there have been a lot of discussions that the stormwater drains should not contain the sewage and the solid waste which enters the stormwater drain. So if we just take about, for an example, that half a meter of the stormwater drain will be comprising of the sewage and the solid waste and the silt that is deposited. So there is no place for the rainwater to flow through these stormwater drains. Now, BBMP in March had said that they were prepared to deal with the flood-like situation, if at all Bangalore witnesses one, since they would be carrying the desilting of the stormwater drains. But the desilting of the stormwater drains could not be finished. And second, the desilting of the lakes, which were in progress, that have not been completed. Thereby, all these reasons, when we comprise, we come to the conclusion that this was one of the major reasons why the city got flooded.
And now, considering this, what action is the administration planning to take to tackle this problem?
So, BBMP, after the chief minister visited the flooded areas early this week, he has given state instructions that all the encroachments should be removed from the stormwater drains. Now, the BBMP chief commissioner, Tushar Girinath, yesterday said that they have identified the locations where the properties have to be demolished. And on some locations, they have already did that. They have started demolishing their properties. Now, the biggest problem is that some of these notices which were already sent to the property owners long time ago, some of these issues are still before the court. And till the legal procedures get completed, the demolitions could not be completed. So that's one of the major reasons.
And in the end, we talk about Uttar Pradesh. Recently, Indian Express's Maulshree Seth, who reports on UP politics for the paper, wrote about something rather unusual, especially in the context of the state where political rivalries are extremely strong. And what she wrote about was that state legislators from opposing parties are now coming together to help their constituencies. For example, Alam Badi and Harshvardhan Bajpai. Now, these two have very little in common. Badi is Muslim, Bajpai is Hindu. Badi is 86 while Bajpai is 42. And while Badi is a veteran leader from the Samajwadi Party, Bajpai is a second-time MLA from the BJP. So how is it that two people who are so different have come together to do something? Maulshree says that it all started with Satish Mahana, who recently became the Speaker of the State Assembly.
So, and UP is one of the largest assemblies of the country. So having 403 MLAs. So he thought that in order to have a better functioning of the house, so it's better to have a one-on-one interaction with all the MLAs so that he knows about them individually. So he thought of having a meeting them in groups, because once you meet 403 people all at once, it's practically not possible to have one-to-one interaction with all of them at a time.
So he decided that he will meet them in groups. Though he formed these groups based on professional backgrounds, age, and their experience. And he also formed a group that just included women legislators. And through this, he found that the assembly has 18 doctors, 16 engineers, 15 with management degrees, over 70 with law degrees, 47 women, and 126 first-timers.
So they are from different fields. So when all of these professionals, MLAs, who have been elected from different political parties, but they sat down on one particular table with the speaker, many of them said that we never thought, like you mentioned about Alam Badi. Alam Badi had his engineering degree, say, about 5 decades back. He said, over the period of time in my profession as a politician, I had actually forgotten that I had long time back taken a diploma in engineering. So you kind of reminded me of that.
She says that keeping people's professional degrees in mind was refreshing, because most of the time people just point to the fact that over 50% of the MLAs in the state have a criminal background. This is also the reason why younger MLAs took to this initiative, which included Amitabh Bajpai, who has an MBA degree from the Bundelkhand University.
He comes from a family of professionals who said that my mother is a professor and my father is a retired custom officer, but I ended up being in politics, even though before this I had taken an MBA degree and I had actually gone out and had started my professional career as an export executive. Since I came into politics, I almost forgot that I had a degree and I could put that to use in my day-to-day functioning of the assembly as well. And he said, after this meeting, I immediately went to my constituency and formed WhatsApp groups. and segregating most of the problems or the issues that the people in the assembly raise. He said that most of the issues are related to either roads or irrigation or power. So I formed a group each having the district level officers of or zonal level officers, since it's a constituency, his constituency in a district. So zonal officers of that particular department in that group. And as soon as anybody sends a picture of the problem, say potholes on the road, he sends it to the group where officers of PWD or other related departments. And immediately he seeks officers respond on the very same place. And if they say, okay, the funds are required, then he takes up the issue with the government. And if the funds are released, so he says it's now it's easier to do a follow-up because everybody is uploading the particular updates of the particular project on those WhatsApp group. And nobody can say, okay, I had told that officer and he is doing it because everybody is on that WhatsApp group. So if somebody says that the file has gone to one particular department, so that officer has to respond on that group. So it's like one-to-one and it's not wasting time calling up officers to meet them personally, kyun nahi hua, kaise nahi hua and all that. So everybody is answerable on that WhatsApp group.
Now this exercise helped other groups as well. For example, after the meeting with those who had medical degrees, it was suggested that these MLAs should become a link between the district chief medical officers and the government.
So if a CMO might be able to discuss things better with the public representative, because the concern also came out that usually officers feel that politician would not be able to understand their problem. But it came out that if somebody has a medical background, so they might be able to understand things better. So why not act as a link if somebody is there having a medical background? So act as a link between the district health officials as well as the government to take up issues of his constituency or the district at the government level. Or for example, if somebody, as I said, people with the management background, so they could help out devise ways or things to address public grievances at ease, to find out ways which can make it easier. Probably it can help out other legislatures also to devise ways which can help their particular constituency. So if they set an example, others can follow as well. So that way they would be able to put their management degrees to use as well.
And she says that when the speaker met the women MLAs, he was surprised to find out that many of them felt that they were not given enough time to speak in the assembly and were hesitant to speak up, especially considering the fact that out of the 403 elected members, only 47 are women.
So either some of them felt sidelined or some of them felt that they do not get proper chance, or they are hesitant to fearing that people might, whatever they are trying to say, they might put them down. So speakers told these women MLAs, as public representative, you're born beyond the issues of gender and caste. So when he heard the issue, so he kind of promised these MLAs that, okay, I'll try to put the issue before the business advisory committee and suggest that one day is set aside just for the women legislators to speak. But another thing came forward that because there are a large number of women MLAs who are first timers, who might be having a professional, but they are first timers. So they are not very well aware of the proceedings of the house and they are sometimes hesitant to ask others. So some of the senior MLAs, irrespective of the parties who have been there in the assembly for 2-3 times, they came out and said, okay, I can help you out, whatever issues you have, since the state assembly has also started with the tablet system where everything is online. So these women MLAs said, okay, you can come up and ask me like how to ask a question or how to go ahead with it, how to put up a question. So that kind of created a separate bonding among different women MLAs, which was beyond the party lines.
Now, the question is, how did the speaker manage to convince these legislators to do this? Maulshree says that the speaker has been part of the assembly for 32 years. And so he simply asked the legislators one question. Do you want to know how to get elected for 8 terms? This is what caught their attention. They too wanted to get elected multiple times. Now, members of the oppositions did raise concerns that it is easy for members of the ruling party to get things done, like coordinating with the CMOs and the government. But what about them?
So, a speaker said that I have been a part of the opposition party also. So it's like if you have to ensure that you are elected irrespective of how your party performs across the state, so you have to ensure how you work in the constituency. So he created a common ground for everybody to be active or to perform better in their respective constituency.
You are listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show was written and produced by me, Shashank Bhargava, and was edited and mixed by Suresh Pawar. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can tweet us at Express Podcasts and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.